And this is what we touched on this morning, and we went through some of these topics that we have touched on. And we started in this series, and we still go out all the way up to Christmas, or just Christmas Eve. Okay. Do you know that 23rd is called Christmas Eve? Because Christmas Eve is 24th. So the Eve before Christmas is the Eve before Christmas. Is the Eve before the Eve of Christmas. So Christmas, we call that Christmas Eve, right? So until then, and this year on we're teaching this transformation series, and then next year when we do a Bible study, we will start on the Gospel of John, the translation. But until then, in our Bible study, we're also talking about something related, which is more the strengths and weaknesses of men of God, so that we can grow in the things of God. So this morning we have touched on. We take you from the series. We started with how transformation or transfiguration is equal to the kingdom of God. That's obvious when you study that Jesus actually was trying to show what the kingdom of God is like when he was transfigured. And secondly, we also see that the kingdom of God will be established during the time of the ten toes. That's a major thing. And since it is important, we see that there is also a timing when this transfiguration process will go into full gear. So it's in the time of the ten toes. And then we also see how the Antichrist will rise for 1 hour with the ten toes based on Revelation chapter 17. It says that the ten kings will rise for 1 hour with the beast. And that's where we get the phrase there. So we call that the 10 plus 1 kingdom. The 10 plus 1 kingdom. And this kingdom is the first attempt to rise up and create a kingdom. Antichrist's motive is to create that. But that rise will fail because it's opposed by the glorious church, which is the kingdom of God set up. So God sets up the kingdom of God. Now you also know the reason why God chose this time to set up the kingdom. In a sense, he set it up from the time of Jesus, but it's growing inside us until it began to affect the natural world. It's because God purposely wants the human race to challenge the rule and reign of the enemy. And so he chose the appropriate time. And then, of course, the Antichrist in Daniel chapter 7 will uproot 3 of the 10 toes. So when minus 3 becomes 7. And so it's no more 10. No more 10 plus 1. So 10 plus 1 only lasts for 1 hour, according to Revelation 17. So suddenly it's 7 plus 1. 7 plus 1. So in this kingdom here, it is the 7th kingdom, the 7th head, which will rise to try to rule the world. And so there will be a division of the earth, of kingdom of light, where the kingdom of God exists, and versus the kingdom of the enemy. But the enemy's kingdom is being pressed and pushed so that it cannot rise until the church is raptured. And that will be where, once the church is raptured, it will be the 7 plus 1. And the 7 plus 1 partly exists before the rapture, because in the year 2029 is when the Antichrist will uproot 3 of the kingdoms. And then he will start to try to rule, but the church will be opposing that. And we know some of the years because of prophecy that the Lord has given. And put it this way, the events, 100%, is in the Bible. But the dates and time are what we give as we encounter the angels and they spoke to us of. So, if you only want to believe in the Bible, at least believe in the events. If you choose not to believe some of the prophecies we receive, that's also fine. But the teaching remains the same. That will take place. It's a question of when. So a lot of scholars are guessing when and how, and they are wrestling with, even today, they are wrestling with Brexit. So on the internet, you find some scholars and some prophetic sites saying, maybe, you know, the European nation will be, they grew under 28, 29 nations, they will reduce back to 10. But what they don't know is that UK has always been, will always be part of the 10 toes. So you can never pull the toe away. And so some of them are funny. You know what? They interpret prophecy based by newspapers. It's a change. So this one happening. Oh, reinterpret. This one happening. This is the wrong way to interpret prophecy. Because then you are not in, you are not holding on to prophecy. As far as I know, as far as I know God, that Brexit, even if it succeeds for some time, will get back together. Or the other possibility, it never succeeds. Because for sure, and then we do with assurance, for sure, UK will be part of the 10 toes. Cannot pull. And even today, every time I pray, I join the Archangel of Europe to the Archangel of UK, and they are bound so solidly, the angels cannot be pulled apart. You know what the angels are doing in each of these 10 toes? They are looking at the angel in angel in Europe. So they are like giving their allegiance to him. And from what I know of the Bible, unless the angels permit, and they're working on behalf of mankind, nothing can happen. Nations rise, nations fall, empires rise, empires fall, based on the work of archangels behind the scene. And that one easy to prove from the Bible, book of Daniel. Remember what Gabriel said after he spoke to Daniel? Daniel said, oh, I must go and fight against the prince of Persia. And then he must go also and help. He's the one who actually helped the Middle Persian Empire to rise. Behind all these things are angels working with us. Well, I better give you some scriptures in case there is anyone new hearing these teachings and you wonder where in the world we're getting all this information from. It's the Bible. See, this is the word of Gabriel. If you look at the context, this is the conversation of Gabriel talking to Daniel. So it starts with chapter 10 of Daniel, verse 20. And he says, do you know why I have come to you? Gabriel asked Daniel. And now I must return to fight with the prince of Persia. But by the way, do you know the answer to the question? Say, what question? That the question Gabriel asked Daniel. Which he said, do you know why I have come to you? Daniel never replied. He looked down all the way. All these details, information that the angels... See, sometimes angels are permitted to give information. Sometimes they're not allowed to say a single word. And look, it's a long, long time. Wow, one whole chapter. Plus, go into chapter 12. Wow, talk about Michael. And then tell Daniel, oh, you, Daniel, shut up all these words. And then I, Daniel, look. And that was it. That so long conversation. Daniel never answered the question. Do you know why I've come to you? Right. The reason he came was to give Daniel information about these end times. Daniel lived and died a wonderful life, faithful to God. He never saw anything come to pass. But he was given this information to write down for our sakes. But in the background, this is what we have. That in chapter 10, okay, scrolling. Do you know why I've come to you? Hallelujah. And he says, and now Gabriel says, I must return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I have gone forth, indeed the prince of Greece will come. See what? Prince of Persia, prince of Greece, these are domains of the enemy. He is not talking about human beings. He's not fighting human beings. He's fighting fallen angels, demonic powers. Because sometimes human beings, fallen angels, like to do their own will. Correct? We're always trying to do that all the time. But the will of God will always be established. That is why Jesus teaches us to pray, Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And the rest, give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. For yours is the kingdom and the power forever and ever. Amen. In Jesus' name. But God is always interested in His kingdom coming. Everyone who prayed the Lord's Prayer, Thy kingdom come, Thy kingdom come, Thy kingdom come. Jesus, when He preached the gospel, and He says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And then for 40 days after His resurrection, before Jesus Christ was ascended on high, Jesus talked to them about the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. And when they started preaching, they talked about the kingdom of God. And Paul himself said, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy. So they're always talking about the kingdom. And there we are praying, the kingdom come, the kingdom come. But in the days of the Tentos, the kingdom is set up, which is our time. So imagine all the prayers of 2,000 years are for us. Everyone who prayed the prayer, Thy kingdom come, has been praying for us. Thank you. Kind of thing. You know, they've really been praying. We are saturated by so much of this prayer. And so when Gabriel was talking to Daniel, you look at the context. Here is the background. It was in verse 1, the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia. So it's the Medo-Persian Empire, which was the second empire that was going on. And then he says, the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. Behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I have been left alone there with the kings of Persia. Can you see the plural singular? Look at the plural singular. The prince, one guy. The kings. So when he talk about the prince, it's more like a principality, power, fallen angel. So there was, Cyrus was a good king. Remember, Cyrus loved Jesus. He loved the people of God, and he was going to sign the edict and let them go back. And Darius the Mede, he's a Mede. The Medes and the Persians are like two cousin groups, and they rule together. But sometimes there are human beings inside each one that try to turn things away. And what is happening is they will take turns to rule. So, you know, the Persians, the Medes, Persians. They sort of like agree to that. Dominion together. It's called the Medo-Persian Empire. You can read about it in history. The Medes and the Persians. So there are many kings in Persia, and there are many kings that are from the Medes. Darius was from the Medes, Cyrus was from the Persians. And they like take turns. But overall, they are called like Persian kings, because Persia is the higher horn. Persia is the higher horn. So, if Cyrus was a good guy that the angels were helping, who was this bad guy, the prince or king of Persia? He's standing against Gabriel for 21 days. And then Gabriel was, Gabriel has been left alone. That means he was the only archangel there working with the kings of Persia. So, there's a lot of forces trying to tear the Persian kingdom apart or try to prevent it from being Middle Persian Empire, maybe trying to make it just Persian Empire or something like that. And then Gabriel also says this, that in chapter 11, verse 1, as in also in the first year of Darius the Mede, I stood up to confirm and strengthen him. See, the word confirm is from the Hebrew word hezek, which means to cease, to cure, to help, to repair, to bind, to conquer. to aid. And strengthen is, of course, you know the word to strengthen him, make him a fortress. When the good kings reign, it was Gabriel involved in the background. No king, no emperor can rise without the help of the archangels. Until mankind mature, it at the moment, God has delegated to the angels who work together with us. And I can say this, the archangel of United Kingdom does not want Brexit. The people may want. Satan would like to stop the prophecy from being fulfilled. If the 10 toes become 9 toes, or 8 toes, or 8.5 toes, suddenly prophecy is hindered. And thus, just considering the Bible, we don't prophesy based on newspaper. We don't prophesy based on news. You prophesy based on what the Lord show you. That is true prophecy. Because what is prophecy? Thus says the Lord. And the Bible says, and thus says the Lord, are equal, correct? When you say, the Bible says, that is as good as thus says the Lord. And the Bible says the 10 toes will be 10 toes. Won't be 9 toes, won't be 8.5 toes. And there will always be big toes followed by 3 little toes when 1 little toe. On his leg, that is. So, there are angels right now working. But if you go to internet, which I just recently went this morning, and because I was putting together part of the information for us about what the revised Roman Empire, some of them are backing out from the prophecy. All because they see the news. But they forgot. There is something more powerful than the human will. The will of God. So the 10 toes will remain intact because in the year 2027, we saw that UK was part of the European Union, making war together with Germany and France against Russia. So if that is the future we see, what we see happening, that one not permanent. It will always revert back to that. And even today, God, Father God, send more angels into UK to stop the process, release your mighty powerful angels and cut across the whole domain. Everyone who receives the word of the Lord, the scriptures, let the power of your word cut them, that they may be humble and allow the word to come forth. And you foul demon power that is inciting things against the written word, go and never come back to Europe. You are cast out into the far darkness. Seal that line and draw the line around the domain of the 10 toes. We draw it and we include United Kingdom. Seal that, Father, in Jesus' name. Now, Gabriel says he's the one helping the Iris to rise up. Now, why is he pushing against the prince of Greece? Now, he said, he even knows exactly how many human beings will come. He says, I tell you the truth. Behold, 3 more kings will rise. See, they know even the exact number of human beings. So, don't tell me God doesn't know how many presidents there will be in the United States before United States fall. You think God doesn't know that? Of course you know. Don't tell me God doesn't know how many prime ministers will exist in any country before the demise? Of course he does. When the demigod doesn't know how many emperors will exist, whether the whole Holy Roman Empire or the Roman Empire before the demise. God knows every single individual. It's all recorded, actually. You know, our news is history to God. It's a recorded history. Way in the past. All our future is history to God. So the angel knew there will be three more kings. And at that time, when he was speaking to Daniel, it was Cyrus. The famous Cyrus prophesied by Isaiah. And why? Why Cyrus? Why are the angels, the big guns, they call it? Gabriel is a big gun. Correct? Unless some of you think that Gabriel is a coochie-coochie small little angel. It's one of the biggest! Gabriel, Michael, Fanuel, and Raphael, forming the formation. Of course, there are seven of them, plus three more who are in different things. And by the way, Archangel Uriel is in charge, according to the book of Enoch, of Tartarus. You know what Tartarus is? What, the domain of the enemy. That's why he's a warring one. And so, and also of the 12 gates. It's important for us to know the domain of each angel. Why are they so concentrated in the time of Daniel? Why? Why? Oh, why? Shakespeare would say, why? Why? Because of prophecy. Do you know God is interested in prophecy? God is interested in His Word. In the Old Testament, it was prophesied that Cyrus would be the one. Way before Cyrus was born. Let's show you all this thing. Okay, you highlight the word Cyrus. And why? Cyrus. Cyrus, yes. 19 hits. But the one you're interested in is actually Isaiah's prophecy. Isaiah lives hundreds of years before Cyrus. And he prophesied. And God has prophesied names of kings before the king was born. So he prophesied by Isaiah. Remember, Isaiah prophesied before Israel's exile. That means Isaiah lived before the Babylonian kingdom. He lived before the Babylon kingdom. He was and it's after him that then you have Jeremiah. Then after Jeremiah, the Babylonian kingdom came. And so it's hundreds of years before Cyrus, because Cyrus was the second kingdom after Babylon. And say, who says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure, saying to Jerusalem, you shall be built. At that time, Jerusalem not even destroyed. Before Jerusalem destroyed, God prophesied destruction and the building. Just like Jesus told Peter, before he denied Jesus, Jesus says, you will deny me, but after you're strengthened, strengthen your brethren. So before Peter even fell, he talked about Peter, about his falling away and denying. That's how far advanced God is. And say, to the temple, your foundation shall be laid. And then chapter 45, thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held, to subdue nations before me. So this is under Isaiah. And now you know, angels are at work to make sure the word comes to pass. And the devil is at work to make sure God's word cannot come to pass, or is delayed, or is stopped. Correct. What is written is written. The Bible says is as good as thus says the Lord. I don't need a new prophecy. Although we do have new prophecies. We just, even the Bible says, the 10 toes will always remain 10 toes. Cannot be divided. So guess what? Angels are at work to push you came back and remained there. So we do not depend on the news. We tell you the news to come. We tell you the news to come and what will come. And so we show forth that it is all under the timing of God as to when these things take place. But we also know this. We humans have been shown to be imperfect, and we are not capable to rule and reign without Jesus. The Holy Roman Empire shows that when the church has spiritual power and natural power, the church becomes corrupt. Power, absolute power, corrupts absolutely. We cannot handle it because of sin nature. And you know, you might see people, you know, nice. Watch and see. You give them a lot of power, suddenly the evil come out. Or you see humans, nice. You give to one of them unlimited money. See what happened to the guy? Suddenly the person began to do things that you never thought you would do. Because they cannot handle money. So, the same way. You imagine how much God has to build into us before He trusts us with money, with power, with spiritual influence. And this is what God wants to do. That's why this revival is important. And we have said, human being 1.0, the way we were in Adam, the way we are fallen, 1.1, 1.2, and all that, is not good enough. We need humans 2.0, which is Jesus, the second man. So we call Him version 2. Jesus version 2. And Jesus is the second version and the perfect version of what new humans can be. No sin nature. Humble. Understand that they are nothing without Jesus, who came not to rule but to serve. Where the principle is a kingdom of love, not a kingdom of fear. Where it is he who is greatest among you is the servant of all. These are the principles of the kingdom. But even in our modern church, we don't see that. Mega church pastors behave like they are pop stars. Everywhere go, got 10 bodyguards. Maybe, you know, make them wear black suits and sunglasses and they will look like some prime minister or president. I don't see that happen to Jesus. Don't forget, I've also pastored church of 1,000 or more. I've crowds of that. But I have never changed. I've always come down right to the basic. And I know what it's like out there. And it's, you know. And I keep telling these people. And I remember telling the present new creation pastor, I said, when you are big, remember what I taught you. Do not do what everybody is doing. So I've told them that, and in the judgment day, you know, those words will come forth. And I said to some of the biggest church pastors today, before they became big, and I said, remember, now I help you. When you're big, help others. And so it's important for us to understand that even today, if the pastors themselves cannot handle big churches, how much more can they handle the world? Unfortunately, and sadly, some good non-Christians display more righteousness than Christians. And they display more intelligence on how to handle things than Christians. You give the power authority to some Christian, they will spend all the nation's resources, perhaps out of a blind and naive faith in Jesus, when they spend everything for the gospel. It is not right. Even if you're Christian and you rule a whole country, if in your country 50% of the people are not Christians, you must spend money also on the 50%. You know, only a dumb Christian would think that he has a right to spend 100% of the country's resources on 50% of the people. See, that's not righteousness. Do you understand? That's not righteousness. Righteousness governs everyone and must take care of everyone, whatever their belief system. That is why it takes a different type of Christianity to handle power, to handle empires which are coming forth, to handle the kingdom of God. And we need lots of wisdom. We cannot use the wisdom of the world either. We must understand how to govern. And there have been attempts made by some Christians to even build cities. Zion by Alexander Davy was one attempt. It was a failure. Because humans are still humans. We need to be understanding and wise of how to do some things. That is why only humans 2.0 can rule the world. 1.0 failed. We don't have to repeat history. The Holy Roman Empire is a history that records the failure of the church to rule the world. The world became worse. Evil continued right up to the very rulers themselves. The papacy became so corrupt that today you read about it, it will make your face blush, the things that are done. It shows that we need humans 2.0. And then this morning we touch on the mystery of the wounded head. And that is found in Revelation chapter 13, the Antichrist kingdom. So bring you to where we were this morning in Revelation chapter 13. This is a verse that talk about the rise of the Antichrist. And there were seven heads and 10 horns. This is the Antichrist. And then John observed in verse 3, I saw one of his heads has been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. So firstly, we deal with the mystery of the seven heads, because later on it tells us here in chapter 17, Revelation chapter 17, John was told by the angels there were these beasts with seven heads and 10 horns. The addition was a woman sitting on a beast. And he says in verse 9, here's the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains. Because the 10 horns are the 10 kings. And he says, five have fallen, one is to come. So John was living under number 6. There was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 before him. And so, some scholars try to interpret it all as Roman general, Roman emperors, but I had a look. They were pushing it too much. You know, there were more than 5 emperors before John. And so they're just trying to squeeze history to fit prophecy. You never do that. You just take history without squeezing it as it is. And don't try to rewrite history. But there were 5 kingdoms that had affected Israel. And that is Egyptian Empire, Assyrian Empire, Babylonian Empire, Medo-Persian Empire, Greek Empire. And these 5 are gone. Number 6 was the Roman Empire. So that's why we got 6 empires have passed. One more empire is coming after John. And the one more empire that is coming is verse 12. It is the 10 kings who have received no kingdom as yet, But they receive authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast. And you know what happens? After the Roman Empire, including the Holy Roman Empire, was deposed in the year 1806 by Napoleon Bonaparte. Remember, Napoleon actually marched into Rome. You have the 10 toes, correct? So the 10 toes keep trying to rise in power. Do we have the little map of the 10 toes again? Just show the 10 toes. What happened? Because remember, the statue, golden head, silver chest, bronze belly, iron legs, 10 toes made of clay and iron. So all those empires have disappeared, and gone until John the Apostle was living in the Iron Empire, which was the Roman Empire. So after Roman Empire, it's supposed to be bang, 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 the 10 toes, correct? But before the 10 toes, you have all this ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba before it becomes the 10 toes. Just like after Alexander the Great died. The prophecy in the book of Daniel says, in the book of Daniel, says that his empire will be divided into four parts. But if you read the history of Alexander the Great, that after he died, his generals fought among themselves. At first it looked like could be five, could be six, could be seven, could be whatever. Then bang, 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 settled into four, exactly like the Bible said. He divided the four empires. So the same way, after the Roman Empire fell, you got a period of chaos. For some time, France became very powerful. Da 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 da! Right? Of course, that might not be the theme song in Napoleon Bonaparte. But anyway, do you know that there is a possibility? There is a possibility that Beethoven's piece, The March of the Emperor, you remember that tune, right? Fifth Symphony. And you hear the Fifth Symphony, you go, right, The March of the Emperor, might have been written for this guy. And so, out of the 10 toes, suddenly, one by one, each toe want to be strong. Hooga, 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 all kind of thing, right? So, here comes France. And it rise, conquer, 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 until he even went all the way to Russia, correct? And so, then, got conquered by United Kingdom. And then while United Kingdom was rising, Spain also empire come out. Ah! And then Portugal also come out. Ah! You see, the 10 toes are trying to rise. They don't want to align nicely. I'm king! No! I'm king! The angel said, I'm king! You shall be king together. King together? No! Ah! See, so much work, eh? The angels have to work. Because that is why, remember, Gabriel says, I now go to fight against the Prince of Greece. Because the Prince of Greece want to come too fast. Say, not your turn, get back! Right, this human power, try to rise. And so, we went into a period when one by one these 10 toes want to be the empire. But no way, they have to come as 10. With the beast. The beast is Russia. And then, so you got the France time, then you got the Spain, then you got the Portuguese, and they influenced the world. Until today, there's a lot of people in South America speak Portuguese. In Brazil, they speak Portuguese. In other parts, they speak Spanish. The influence remain. And then, isn't the United States basically a pilgrimage of these English people there? That's why English is their spoken language. English, not Americanish. Their origins are from these 10 toes. Can you see history from the Bible? Don't just see history from your history books. See history from the Bible prophecy. that after the Roman Empire fell, the Holy Roman Empire, which replaced the Roman Empire, that lasted, the Holy Roman Empire lasted until 1806. Yes, it was longer than the Ottoman Empire that came and affected them a bit, longer than the Mongolian Empire, which came, you know, in the first few of the about 1200, 1300, and 1400, and influenced a lot of the world, influenced China especially, when Kublai Khan ruled over China, and I think they named it the Yuan the dynasty. And so all these are history, but look at history from the Bible. It's the record of the rise of these empires. And the Mongolian Empire that rose, it was because the kings of the east trying to rise and then got pushed back. And each one trying to rise. And the same with the area of the Ottoman Empire. The leftover of the Ottoman Empire is found in Turkey. Remember Constantinople? It's still there. Except that it's no more empire, it's just a country now. So each of these tried to go big, then got pushed back. Yeah. France, got pushed back. And then First World War, you know, which basically started from this region here, where is the Serbians here. And then got pushed back. And then Poland is gone, some all these countries grow smaller. You see, the tentacles were forming without you and I knowing. And then Second World War, where's Germany? The number one here, right? Yep. Ah, here it is. You go, got pushed back also. And then Japan, got pushed back. See, kings of the east also trying to rise. Tell you, angels got a lot of job. Slapping people down. Of course, they don't actually do it. They just use the sword. But you think that just because we are in the modern time, you think the angels all retired? What about all Gabriel, Michael, you know, all retired, all that sit down? They all got technology and science now. We all just see and watch them happening. No such thing. They are still working. They're still working. And they are still making sure the tentacles remain tentacles. And only recently, and of all things, you know that the vote for Brexit occurred when I was actually there, launching that COG UK. No coincidence. And so now it's trying to pull away. What do you think the angel will do? Go back! There are angels working. So watch the news. And you find it is tough to fight against the angels of God. You will lose. If you don't lose a whole leg, at least the thigh bone is gone. Remember Jacob and the wrestling. So and these are warring angels in charge. So in the end, after the Second World War, which ended in 1945, 3 years later, in 1948, Israel became a nation. Finally, after 2,000 years, 2,000 years from when, you know? From the Roman Empire, when they were destroyed. During the Roman Empire, they were divided into three sections. Remember the tetrarch kind of thing, three main rulers. Then, Jerusalem was still preserved. But in AD 70, the date is significant. Under General Titus of the Roman Empire, he tore down everything, including the temple. Remember Jesus says, these stones that are here, the disciples walk with Jesus. Jesus said, all this will be torn down. It took place in AD 70. And not only that, they took all the Jews and they took them away from the land. So they were lost. And for 2,000 years, there were no such thing as Israel anymore. By the time they came back, Hebrew was a dead language. It's a dead language. Nobody spoke it. They spoke a mixture of Aramaic and Yiddish. And it took one brilliant scholar his life is recorded by Gordon Lindsay. He revived the Hebrew language. And then he taught his children Hebrew. And they were the only speaking Hebrew-speaking people. And from there it spread. So when Israel formed as a nation, they got him to help, to revive. And it is a miracle. It's the only dead language in the world that is revived into a modern language and spoken. The 2,000 years. So Israel finally became a nation in the year 1948. And in the year 1948, all these nations finally settled in. Of course, some like Czechoslovakia, you know, was still big, which slowly still breaking up in our modern days. But these are the major 10 areas. I put Scandinavian countries together, all of them. The one in blue stars are the one that the angels actually spoke of us. And the angel didn't give us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, never. But in conversation with them, as we took down notes, the angels did mention, hey, where's the thing? Okay, the map. The angels did mention, those countries by the blue stars. So, yeah, we're trying to find it again. Okay. So the one that I marked with blue stars are the names of countries that in the conversation with angels, they actually mentioned those countries by name. So they did mention Greece, Italy, and this one, no star. They did mention France, Spain, UK, and Netherlands, and Germany. So the others, they did not mention, but they talk about this. So that's why I put a star, that means we actually heard in prophecy. And we know they continue to be important as the 10 tigers, 10 horns, 10 toes that exist. And then we came to this, the wounded head, remember? So we say there are only three possible theories to explain the wounded head. Number one, the wounded head could be explained by the Roman Empire being defeated. And then it crashed. And then it rise again. So it becomes the 10 toes revised Roman. So it's like Roman Empire 2.0. But then this morning, I took you to history to show what the European Union is, and Italy, where Rome is no more power. The only time that someone tried to revise Roman Empire, the Rome's to their fullness, was under Mussolini with Hitler, but it did not succeed. So Italy would never be a world power again. And the capital of the European Union is not in Rome, it is in Brussels, Belgium. And so it's important for us to know that the European Union is not a repeat of the Roman Empire. In fact, there is no mention that it's a revised. Just because it's iron and clay doesn't mean that it's Roman. It's just something new. It is the seventh empire under the Antichrist. But it only lasts a short time because it's concurrent with the kingdom of God. So the kingdom of God pushes it. And thus, there is a rule of the kingdom of God until the rapture. And that's where we show that if the wooden head is a revised Roman Empire, what is so Roman about, you know, the EU? What is, just because a few treaties are signed there, you know, there's nothing. It's a totally different empire. And the word revised Roman Empire is not found in the Bible. It's something scholars invented. Of course, this morning I read to you some prophecies give 40 reasons why EEU is the revised Roman Empire. And then I show you the contrary writing that some says, no, it doesn't exist. And so we say that if the wounded head represents a defeated empire, logically, all the five heads should also be wounded. Because the Babylonian Empire got conquered by the Medo-Persian got conquered by the Greece got conquered by the Roman. Correct. How come all the other heads are not wounded when the empire die? No answer. So to try to put it as conquest, couldn't explain. Couldn't explain fully. But that was before we went into this. The only explanation you have is actually A. Someone had to invent RRE, Revised Roman Empire, to explain. Imagine they invent a whole thing to explain the wounded head. Then the second possibility about wounded head was that Christ, in the time of the Roman Empire, defeated Satan and his cohorts. Hebrews 2:14, Colossians 2, verse 14 and 15. But I have a problem with that. Because in chapter 13 of Revelation, the wounded head was healed. How can something that Christ do to the devil and his fallen angel be undone? Jesus has the keys of hell and death. I think and I believe it's obviously still in the hands of Jesus. Why do you think Jesus lost his key? Go for a far trip. Oh, where's my key? No, Jesus still has the keys of hell and death. Satan cannot, I repeat, fallen angels cannot, I repeat, undo what Jesus did. His victory is absolute and complete. If Jesus is the one who gave the wooden head, I tell you, nothing can heal it. So, it's not talking about what Jesus has done, although what Jesus has done is fantastic. It has to be talking about something that the devil can undo. The only place where he can deliver the wounded head is the kingdom of God, established in the time of the ten toes. Remember, Satan is trying to rise to the ten toes. So he goes, yeah, 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 the ten toes, Russia and the ten toes. And then, in the day of the ten toes, the kingdom of God is set up. The stone, remember? Kabang! That's when the wounded head got. His kingdom is crushed under the kingdom of light. The powder, the pieces, and you got the empire of Christ, I call it. And that's why after the rapture, Satan's kingdom, or the Antichrist kingdom, is also number 8. Which Revelation 17 call it number 7 and number 8. Because number 8 is, they don't have 8 heads. Correct? So where is number 8? You got only a creature with 7 heads and 10 horns. 10 horns, we already know who they are. So how is the Antichrist number 7 and number 8? Here are the scriptures. Chapter 17. Okay. You have the beast. He says, verse 11. The beast that was not, is not, that means didn't exist yet, the kingdom, is himself also the 8 and is of the 7. So he is the 7 head and is the 8 head. But wait, there's no 8 head. There is only 7 heads, correct? So where did the 8 head come from? It's almost like, remember some of the legends of Hercules, and he fought against this multi-headed thing. When you chop off the head, 2 more head grow. But not like that. Here, which head? Now we also know the mystery. Which of the heads was destroyed? Not number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, which is before. Neither is it number 6, which was the Roman Empire. It was number 7. Is it 7? Yeah, it's 7. It was 7. So when 7 was mortally wounded, kapoom, it grew again. Ta-da! That is why the 7 is the 8. It was not like kapoom, and then it remained like that. Then the 8 came. Yuck! No. the creature only got 7 heads. Correct? Never got 8 heads. So the story was about number 7, which was destroyed and then became number 8. And it still was 7-headed with 10 horns. So mathematically it's correct. In detail, prophecy analysis is correct. And in comparison with all the scriptures, it is correct. And so, last week we introduced you to the subject that the wounded head was caused by the kingdom of God coming forth. And today we establish it from the Bible to show forth in detail. We solve the mystery of the wounded head, finally, which remained unsolved for nearly 2,000 years of Christianity. And why couldn't we solve it? Because we couldn't see who gave him the blow, the death blow. But today, with the advantage of many who have prayed before us, of our predecessors and forefathers of our faith, and because it's the end time, God showed us we were the ones. Which brings you to this. And now, in the second service, since the kingdom of God is the one who gave a mortal, remember, mortal wound means can die. If not treated, can die. So we give a mortal wound to the kingdom of the Antichrist, which is Satan, and we give him a blow that give him half dead. Mortal wound means half dead or nearly dying. And he only escaped by the skin of his teeth. Maybe got no teeth, bogey. So, but managed to get everything back after the church leaves. So now, in the second service, we ask this question. How and when do we give him that mighty blow? When and how? Which we begin to look at scriptures that talk about us. It tells us, I started with 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, that when the Antichrist rises, it says in verse 3, let no one deceive you unless the falling away, which is the word apostasia, which means an apostasy will take place. You see, our church and our modern church is almost like the Holy Roman Empire, sadly, in a sense that worldliness has crept into the church. And as long as worldliness creep into the church, we cannot be transformed. Satan has held us back by offering us the world. And this is an old trick. Remember, he offered to Jesus the world? One of the three recorded temptations. He offered the world and all its empire to Jesus. And Jesus said, no. Jesus refused. And Jesus rebuked the enemy. And so he did not succeed in offering the world to Jesus. Jesus was to take over the world by his own power. And since then, he has offered the world to Christians. But Jesus said, what does it profit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? The Holy Roman Empire was the rule, quote-unquote, of Christianity in the world. At that time, was the Holy Roman Empire under the Catholic Church. It was a sorrowful state. The world came into the church. The church became all about worldly things. It is also not the way of God. Finally, you think in 2,000 years of church history, that in our present state, we can continue to handle the powers of this world. We cannot. human being 1.0 cannot. You need a new type of human being. What type of human being do we need? See, as long as you need food, food will be temptation to you. As long as you need money, money is temptation to you. As long as you need anything in this life, that will be a temptation to you. But when you grow to the stage where you don't need food, don't need money, because your clothing is supernatural. Why do you need to go to supermarket and buy clothing where you could use your mind, think, and I will a clothing change. Your clothing could be angelic clothing. And then you no need to sleep. Where do you need houses? When it comes dark, you say, hey, let's go to the mountain and look and pray. There's no more temptation because your body is not linked to the world. Transformation. So it says, two things will happen in the end time. There will come an apostasy. That means the worldly part of the church will collapse and follow the enemy. The man of sin is Antichrist. Then the Antichrist will be revealed. But notice which one comes first. The church becoming worldly came first. You say, hey, Pastor, really? It's such a materialism. Yeah. Didn't you read your Bible? See, the Bible prophesied. Yeah. Remember the seventh church, what the name is? Laodicea. What is it famous for? I know the first church, Ephesus, is famous for losing their first love. What is the seventh church famous for? Lukewarm, because they think they are very rich. Carnally rich, materialistic. And you know where Jesus is? Outside the church knocking. He's not inside, no, he's outside. Of course, to the overcomers, he's always with them. The lukewarm church is what God is going to cut. And you all know what caused something to be lukewarm? Mixture of hot and cold, you get mixed. Lukewarm. Or you put a bit of heat into the cold water until it's lukewarm. That means a little bit heat, not too much. Or you cool down very hot. So there are three ways you can make lukewarm. You wait till very hot becomes lukewarm. You give enough heat to heat the cold, not too hot, but just to lukewarm. Or you mix both. In the end, God has to separate the world from the church. That is what is causing us to be lukewarm. And when he separates it out, only let those who are hot for God remain. And that has to take place before the Antichrist shows himself. And that is going to be the most difficult part, because it is far easier when the Antichrist is there. And people say, oh, Antichrist, go to him or run away. And then you see the glorious church. Ah, run to the glorious church. But it's harder when it's all mixed together. But it says, when these two come, and the Antichrist will rise and try to be God. And it says, verse 6, now you know what is restraining. Restraining means to hold back, to possess, to seize, to retain. So include conquering. And now you know what is ruling, possessing, and controlling. That he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. The he can refer to Jesus, can refer to Holy Spirit, can refer to the church. You know what the correct interpretation? All three. Because you cannot restrain the enemy without the power of the Holy Spirit. Because you cannot restrain the enemy without the name of Jesus and Jesus being in you. But God needs us. In the time of the Antichrist, what is the Antichrist? The personification of Satan. God will raise the church to be the personification of Christ. So the personification of Christ versus the personification of the devil. That's a death blow that will be dealt with. And so it's tied to these words in Romans chapter 12, which tells us, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. Remember transformation series? By the renewing of your mind. Doesn't that verse tell you you cannot be transformed as long as you're worldly? No matter how much energy God put into you to transform you, as long as the world is inside you, it will suck all the energy away from transformation. So you must chop off the worldly part before the transformation can even begin to come forth. And it was 1 John that tells us, do not love the world nor the things of the world. For if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. This is the verse that I want to show you. Of Father. Let me remove the "the." Okay. And that's it. We want the one in 1 John. This is the verse. Do not love the world. All the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. 1 John. The world is passing away in verse 17. And the last of it. He who does the will of God abides forever. And let me point you to this verse that you're very familiar with. In the Gospel of Mark chapter 4. You all know the parable of the sower and the seed, correct? We know it so well. About four different types of ground. But there's one more thing I want to point out. After Jesus spoke this parable, Jesus interpreted. It's the only parable that Jesus explained very thoroughly. Do you know what the seed actually is? It's the word, but more than that. Look, he says, to you, it has been given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. He is actually talking about a kingdom. Not just about you becoming more spiritual. You will always interpret this parable to be, we become more spiritual. But he's actually talking about his kingdom. And then you look. He said, this is the mystery of how the kingdom will rise up. And then he says, do you not understand this parable? How will you understand all parables? The sower sows the word. Alright? Sower sows the word. Then you got all the other results. But cross-reference to Matthew 13, which is same parable, and it gives you a different aspect. Here it is. He spoke this parable. A sower went to sow the word. So same thing. He describes all the thing with some slight differences. And he says, because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. My first statement is this. The kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven are the same thing. Except you're looking at it from a different angle. The kingdom of God is heaven coming down on earth. That's why it's sometimes called the kingdom of heaven. It is actually heaven ruling on earth. I repeat, it is actually heaven ruling on earth. Amen. Well, this sounds like the stock, right? It is not human being ruling on earth. It is not mankind ruling on earth. Get it into our head. It is not earth ruling earth. Heaven. So the people who rule must become heavenly. Yes. Thank you for filling out the blanks. the people who rule must become heavenly, and they must be trained in heaven to rule on earth. Because you're trained on earth to rule on earth, another Holy Roman Empire. Not good enough. You must rule from heaven. It's heaven ruling on earth. It's the kingdom of heaven. So the more heavenly you become, some of you may say, wow, heavenly, a hard subject. It's all over the Bible. Didn't the Bible say in Colossians chapter 4, verse 1, set your mind on things above. Didn't the Bible say in Ephesians chapter 2, you're raised up and seated in heavenly places. So how can we be sitting in heavenly places and be so carnal? Cannot. The two doesn't go together. You have to be heavenly. You have to have a mind of heaven. A presence of heaven. You got to become a heavenly creature. Until people look at you, wow, angel. You say, can I? Yes. In the book of Acts, Stephen walked so close with God until they look at him, wow, like angel. I didn't make up. I'll come back to this. Acts chapter 7. Look at him. Here is Stephen. He's about to go home. And he preached a great sermon which summarizes Jewish history. Wow, that's a long sermon. And then it says here that, oh yes, okay, there he is. He says, being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven, saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand. And he said, look, I see the heavens open, the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. When did this occur? This occurred even before he started preaching. Which when you trace, he's starting preaching, which is chapter 7. So chapter 6 is when they caught him. And in chapter 6, when they all sat in the council, they look at Stephen. They saw his face like an angel. But by face like an angel doesn't mean the face very sui, you know. Very sweet. But it's the face is shining. Right? You wouldn't, I mean, a lot of people, you know, if you got 1,000 people, 10,000 people, sure you find a few people with very sui face. Sui, by the way, those online, it means beautiful, is it? I hope I got the right word. Okay. Might sound something in other language. Why your face not so sui? You don't mind. You want your wife to be sui sui. Right. Oh, wife of Alex, are thou sui sui? Okay, he said you're suier than him. Okay. But you know, Louis got a formula. Eat more pumpkin seed soup. She loves this pumpkin seed and I like it too. Jehuda knows that. But anyway, no, that's just a joke. I don't anyone get this. I say, well, eat more pumpkin seed, eat more pumpkin seed for transfiguration. This sermon is not sponsored by pumpkin seeds. Right. But I want to point to the fact it's not just saying he was good looking. It is saying there's a light that is there. Isn't that like a mini transfiguration? The only way you can be like heaven is you see heaven. You connect with heaven. And the heavenly light shines on you. Too bad it was just before he go home. But for you and I, when the light shines, it's the beginning of the kingdom of God. Shining. Remember Jesus' transfiguration. So Stephen had walked with God. Here is one man who had walked with God in the New Testament. I know Old Testament, there is a Moses. But by the time you see his face, he was 80 plus. You know? Oh, well, he's into his last 40 years. But it was only his skin. Stephen had a mini transfiguration. They look at him. Angel. Because there was a light that shined. And so, that something about Stephen. When you read about Stephen, what was he like? In verse 8, he was full of faith. Now, no one can be full of faith without being full of the Word. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Which means, humans 2.0. Okay, I need to have this. Humans 2.0, where is my little pen? Humans 2.0. One of their qualifications. Humans 2.0 is they are the Word made flesh. Exactly like Jesus. Because Stephen only has a glimpse. He was full of the Word. But why didn't the Bible then just say he was full of the Word? Because you can be full of the Word but not full of faith yet. The Word has to be converted into the material of faith. And you know what is faith? Faith is a substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. What is the Word? The Word is the container of faith. That's why when you have the Word, you got the potential for faith. You remember the sower sowing the Word? Now, not everybody responds to the Word the same way. Okay. I did do a double tap. Yeah, there he is. Now, come on, faster. I just press you. Yes. Okay. My Bible is now getting slow. Okay. It says, because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And then he explained the parable. He says, look at what word it is. Therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, the word about the kingdom of God, not just the word about how you'll be successful in this life, that one is chap tap sui, which is a little bit, right? Chap tap sui is a little bit, yeah. Okay, chap tap sui, just bonus. It's not just about being rich and powerful. Chapter 6. Matthew 6:33. All these things will be added to you. They're just side benefits. Yeah, you know, a few billion dollars here and there, side benefits. You know? Yeah. A few blessings here and there. All the power of healing, they're all side benefits. The main thing is kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. When you seek first the kingdom of God. But we always read it as seek God first. When did we remove the kingdom? Wallah, we remove the kingdom. Of course. Seek God first, love God first, put God first. All the things. But specifically, seeking God first and seeking the kingdom of God first is two different things. Seeking God first is general. I love you, Lord God, you're first. Seeking the kingdom is you are seeking to bring about the kingdom on earth. You will do everything in your power. You do everything in your prayer. Do everything in your life. You arrange everything in your life for the kingdom. Because he's talking about living this life. And you want to build the kingdom of God. With spiritual means. So the word is the word of the kingdom. That's what I want you to see. Many people don't see that. They only remember Mark 4. But it's the same parable. It's the word about the kingdom. So some people will receive the word of the kingdom. And I've been talking to the angels about this. I asked them this question and I asked Jesus. Oh God. This is the question. For you to think through. Hope you can eat your dinner after that. This is the question. Do all your people reach human 2.0? Why you all laying like that? Why you all not very confident? You're not confident 100% can reach? Okay, let's give you a little bit thing. Well, because it actually depends on time. Will all the humans reach human 2.0 before the rapture?
Yes.
Very good. But how many humans will reach 2.0? When? It's a question of when. That is why you have some will get 34. Some 64. Some 104. My recommendation, be among the 104. Because when the word of the kingdom goes, some people will give 30% of their life. So they get 34. Some will give 60% of their life. So they get 64. Some will be sold out for God, 100%. They get 100%. God is not mocked. Whenever you put God first, you receive the benefit. Whenever you seek the kingdom of God and you understand the rule and reign of the kingdom, but remember all these tests, as you rise into the kingdom, kingdom mentality. Actually, the Bible is full of kingdom mentality. When Jesus first started preaching, he always preached, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. When Jesus rose up from the dead, do you know his whole concentration was on kingdom? And he talked so much of the kingdom until the disciples asked, when will the kingdom of Israel be restored? They think it was only one nation. They forgot it's global. In the book of Acts, it actually says he was talking about the kingdom. After he rose from the dead, his whole focus is on the kingdom. Everything is focused on the kingdom. You see here in verse 3. After his resurrection, Acts 1, to whom he presented himself alive, after his suffering, by many infallible truths, being seen by them, 40 days after his resurrection, for 40 days after his resurrection, speaking of the things, 40 days is a lot of sermon, 40 days is a lot of material, 40 days is a lot of data collected. All the data is far under one section. Kingdom of God. Now, he could have told them a billion things. But he wanted to tell them, it's time for the kingdom. And the mystery is the kingdom of God grows in us. Under this end time, it grows to its fullness. So the word of the kingdom contains things about the kingdom. Jesus said, my words are spirit and life. So the word contains spirit and life. But you must open up the word. It's just like groundnuts. You all know what groundnuts are. You know, groundnuts come in thick shells. They grow under the ground. When you dig them up, you might have to clean it. Then you cook it. You either boil it or you steam it or you open it and then you fry it and you bake it, whatever. But you don't eat the shell. You eat the nuts inside. And that is why when you peel open the word, you find that the contents of the word is faith. A substance of faith. And that substance of faith
is that in which, verse 3, by faith we understand the worlds are framed by the Word of God. That substance frame things. And they frame invisible things. Stephen was not just full of the Word. He was full of faith and power. Remember, the kingdom of God wants to come in power, and the power comes by faith. But that faith is not our faith. It's the faith that is energized by God on the inside. Remember when Peter healed the lame man and pulled him up, Peter explained to them in chapter 3 of Acts, this substance of faith is a real substance. Faith is a substance. And it says here, when the people ask, how is it that this man is healed? How is it possible? And it says, Peter says, do you marvel? Look at, remember, that man has never walked before. That was the first time he walked, and he was walking, leaping, and praising the Lord. Everyone knows him. He's there begging near the beautiful gate. And Peter said, why do you look at us as if by our own power or godliness we make this man walk? He says, how does this man walk? And he says in verse 16, his name, Jesus, through faith in his name, has made this man strong. Then he went to the substance. Yes, the faith which comes from him. See? That drop into him, even one seed of faith can move a mountain. One seed of faith in a man, when Peter looked in his eyes, he saw the faith. He says, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give to you. In the name of Jesus, rise and walk. Paul, in the book of Acts, at Lystra, in chapter 14, there was a lame man there. Paul was preaching. He saw the man had faith. And he shouted to him, stand up! And the man was healed. One drop of faith is all you need. It can give you all. If one drop so powerful, what happened to a man who's full? That's why now you know why his face shining like angel. Full of faith. Full of power. And so we iron that out to be, he was like Jesus, the Word made flesh. Full of faith. That was why it is possible. And then we also see that everything has to be follow Jesus. Spirit without measure. That's how you can reach beyond this life. Everything is based on Jesus. John 14, 12. The works of Jesus, you will do in greater works. Jesus had both. In John chapter 1, verse 14, Jesus was the Word made flesh. You know what the Word made flesh is? The Word is invisible. The Logos that cannot conceive. The Logos suddenly can touch. That's a powerful thing. Even John regards Jesus as this Word made flesh. There are other points that we'll cover, but look at 1 John, and if you read the translation, it actually says, that which we from the beginning we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which look about upon, our hands have handled the Logos of life. Wait, our hands have touched this Logos, this life. It's the life of Jesus. So the Logos was made flesh. And that's the transformation that enable human 2.0. And then, spirit without measure, let me highlight that, and that will be our final words before we continue the next week. Without measure. In the Gospel of John? Okay. Then I'll just highlight spirit. And it's in the Gospel of John. Here is John. the highlight that we, as the Spirit came upon him, born again, the Spirit, okay. Oops, I didn't, here it is. For he, in John 3, 34, he whom God has sent speaks the words of God. For God does not give the Spirit by measure. Jesus is measureless. Do you know potentially when God anointed the church, we are called the Spirit without measure coming. Except we receive it by measure. Because we cannot handle all at once. It's just like in one lifetime, many of you might have eaten a ton of chicken. But you don't eat a ton of chicken at one time. You eat a little bit, a little bit, a little bit. And over your lifetime, you eat a lot. So, the same. Over this revival and over 2,000 years, the church has eaten revelation. Eaten revelation. More and more. Until God released more in this end time and we receive more. As we receive more, measure and measure, it increases us. Until you touch a measure where it overflows to you. The Holy Spirit fills you, overflow to you. The baptism in the Spirit, it flows so full in you that it surpasses you. You are now like swimming. In Ezekiel, it talks about the church will enter into a place where the waters will be above us. That's talking about the glorious church. At first, you start at the anchor level, then you go higher and higher. But you talk about this river, until we are deep inside the river, it's over our head. We are immersed into the river of the Spirit. So that the Holy Spirit is fully in control of us. It's the Spirit without measure. You saw what Elijah could do with a measure of the Spirit. You saw what Elisha can do with double measures. Imagine what you could do with Spirit without measure. He could not do it before because he has to give us a newborn again experience. Our spirit cannot contain. But now our spirit can. You say, Pastor, how do you know it's without measure? Because of this word, fullness. The Bible never talked about fullness under the New Testament. And says that the church will now have the fullness of God. Which is in Ephesians chapter 1. In Paul's prayer, he says about the church, and he concludes, verse 22-23, he put all things under his feet, gave him to be the head over all things, to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Isn't that verse unlimited? How can you say you got the fullness of God when you don't have the fullness of God? It says the fullness is fullness, complete, nothing lacking. And in chapter 2, it says that the church is God's dwelling place, the third temple, the final temple where God dwells. Jesus called his body a temple. We are temples of God. And God dwells in that temple. And in chapter 3, it says that in his prayer, he prayed that Christ may dwell in our hearts. He's already in our hearts. But he's praying for more of Christ to dwell in our heart. How much of Christ? That you being rooted, grounded in love may be able to receive with all the saints. What is the width, the length, the depth, the height of the love of God, to know the love of God which passes knowledge, that you individually and corporately may be filled with all. the fullness of God. And that's the finale. Let's all rise together and thank God for all that He is. Thank you, Jesus. Oh Lord, we release Your Spirit. Let everyone be filled with the Spirit. Those online, be anointed in Jesus' name. Overflow with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit and the Word. The Holy Spirit and the Word we release abundantly upon each one. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you.